डियर चिल्ड्रन, 10th स्टैंडर्ड, आई विल एक्सप्लेन दिस पोएम, द स्टोलन बोट, रिटन बाय विलियम वर्ड्सवर्थ. प्री रीडिंग एक्टिविटी. इमेजिन ए चाइल्ड हैज बीन कॉट स्टीलिंग अ पेन. इन द क्लासरूम नंबर ऑफ टाइम्स वी हैव सीन चिल्ड्रन, सम ऑफ द चिल्ड्रन, they steal pen, and what is their feeling? What will you do if you were the child, you were the HM? So I will first read the poem and then I will explain this. One summer evening, led by her means the boat, a little boat tied to a willow tree. Within a rocky cave, its usual home. So the boat is tied always in that rocky cave. Straight I unloosed her chain. It was tied to a chain, it was unloosed. And stepping in, pushed her from the shore. It was an act of stealing. So here, the poet has stolen the boat. And troubled pleasure. Oxymoron figure of speech, troubled pleasure. Nor without the voice of mountain echoes did my boat move on, leaving behind her still on either side. Still means the still water, small circles glittering idly in the moon until they melted into one track. So as you row the boat, there will be encircling in the water, and soon the encircling, the circles will vanish. A sparkling light, but now like one who rows, proud of his skill to reach a chosen point, with an unswerving line, I fixed my view upon the summit of a craggy ridge. Craggy ridge. The horizon's utmost boundary, far above, was nothing but the stars and the gray sky. She was an elfin pinnace. Lustily, I dipped my oars into the silent lake, and as I rose upon the stroke, my boat went heaving through the water like a swan, when from behind that craggy steep till then, the horizons bound a huge peak, black and huge, as if with voluntary power instinct. Upreared its head, I struck and struck again, and growing still in structure, the grim shape towered up between me and the stars, and still, for so it seemed, with purpose of its own, and measured motion like a living thing, strode after me. Means it came, the craggy ridge came after him, as if he found, imagining that it is following him. With trembling oars I turned, and to the silent water stole my way, back to the covert of the willow tree. Again he takes the boat to the willow tree. There in her mooring place I left my bar, and through the meadows homeward went in grave and serious mood. But after I had seen that spectacle, for many days my brain worked with a dim and undetermined sense of unknown moods of being. Over my thoughts there hung a darkness, call it solitude or blank desertion. No familiar shapes remained, no pleasant images of tree, of sea or sky, no colors of green fields, but huge and mighty forms that do not live. Like living men, move slowly through the mind by day, and were a trouble to my dreams. So now I will explain William Wordsworth. Note on the author, 1770 to 1850. Almost 80 years old, he survived. He is considered one of the greatest poets of English literature. Wordsworth and his friends S.T. Coleridge, by their joint publication of the lyrical ballads, became the harbingers of the romantic movement in English literature. The episode of the stolen boat is based on the experience of Wordsworth's early boyhood days. When Wordsworth was a boy at that time, this is an extract from the book, one of Wordsworth's great philosophical poem, The Prelude. Summary. Young Wordsworth, led by the nature, finds a boat hidden in the lakeside cave. He steals the boat, and vigorous and proud of his youthful skill, heads out onto the lake on a joyride. It's a beautiful scene, with the oars leaving a trail of rippling circles shining in the moonlight, and the boy himself admiring the surrounding ridges and the stars and the sky beyond. But then, this peaceful image takes a scary turn. The sight of the craggy mountain with its huge peak and the play of the night light frightened the boy. But the harder he rows, the more the huge peak seems to come after him. Frightened and trembling, the boy, now humbled, turns around and returns the boat to its mooring and heads for home. Wordsworth, even as a boy, recognizes that this has been a formative experience, a Wordsworthian spot of time that has shaped and continues to shape the poet's adult consciousness. He begins to feel nurtured and disciplined by nature. Nature is referred to as her here. In the poem, it has come here, led by her nature, led by her. By her means nature. The little boat was tied to a willow tree within a rocky cave. The boat was where it was usually tied. Usually the boat was tied there in that place. Hence it is the home to the boat. It is the home of the boat. Her in this line refers to the little boat here. Both nature and the boat tempt the boy, just as a woman would do, thus prompting the poet to refer to them as a woman. Appearance of the boat also is described as elfin. And nature is often referred to as Mother Nature. Elfin means small fairy like a boat. Small fairy like a boat. And nature is often referred to as Mother Nature. Similarly, just as the boat is at home in the cave, he also feels at home with nature. Taking the boat that didn't belong to him was an act of theft. He's stealing the boat here. When the boat moved on, there came echoing sounds, means warning sounds, from the mountain sides. He is what it is imagining, because he has stolen the boat. So the title is The Stolen Boat. The visual is of the boat that left small circles of water gleaming idly under the light of the moon till all of them were mixed up and dissolved, giving way to one single track of glittering light. What is there refers in the poem, this line? There refers to the small circle on the water. It is personification here. They, personification figure of speech on the that is personification figure of speech, led by her. This is also personification figure of speech on the water left by the movement of the boat. Only one huge peak is mentioned. The boat is compared to the swan in line 19 and 20. In line 19 and 20, the boat is compared, similarized to the swan. To highlight the graceful movement of the boat, The pleasure here was that of a boy's thrill of stealing a boat to see the wonders of nature at night. The conscience pricks him on his stealthy act. The pig comes across as a creature in the dark, slowly growing larger in stature, with the awful peak with its towering height that seemed to stand between the poet and the stars. It is imagined by the boy in the silent lake. It is all imagination, threatening and menacing. It was the boy who was trembling, not the oars, but the boy was trembling because he had stolen the boat. The figure of speech used here is personification. The oar trembling like a person. The oars are trembling because the boy is trembling, and so the oars are trembling here. He is frightened by the approaching peak. He finds that the peak is approaching, coming behind him, chasing him. The lasting memory of the actual experience. The boy could not experience happiness and joy from the familiar scenes of nature. Only the huge mountain and the mighty waves occupied his mind. Of all previously known objects and pleasing sights like that of tree, sea, sky, or of colors of green fields, only huge, powerful forms and shapes whose mode of life is absolutely different from that of a man hunted his mind during the day and also troubled the poet in his dreams at night. After tying the boat, when he comes home, he gets dreams, nightmares. She refers here to the boat. She refers to the boat. It is also personification, figure of speech, because it is indicated as she here. Metaphor. The boat is compared to an elfin. Here it is metaphor, figure of speech. Like the elfin, it is a small and delicate. It means small and delicate. The figure of speech used here is personification. The pinnace, which is a fairy-like small boat, is seen as a person. The delicate, graceful, lily-like movements are highlighted. The figure of speech used in the first line is personification. In the first line, it is personification. The horse seems to tremble like a person shaken with fear. The mountain in the night seemed huge and threatening, and so he was trembling with fear. The boy wants to put the boat back where it belonged. The boy, Wordsworth, here actually the boy is Wordsworth here, during his childhood, realized that it was an act of stealing, and his joy and the thrill of adventure was troubled by a sense of guilt. He is feeling guilty because he has stolen the boat. He is uncertain of who to truly blame for his actions, but he succumbs to his own guilt and realizes he has created this troubled pleasure. Troubled pleasure. This is oxymoron, figure of speech. Troubled pleasure. The poem is a description of how Wordsworth dealt with guilt and then acceptance that it was fear that broadened his definition of spirituality and allowed him to feel nurtured and disciplined by nature. Wordsworth is profoundly disturbed when the familiar lake transforms from a place that normally gives him pleasure into a menacing, unreal character. The mountain's towering height seemed to stand between the poet and the stars. It seemed to the poet as if the peak was a living creature. He thought the peak is actually a living creature because he imagined that it is following him with regular steps with some fixed purpose of its own. Many days after he had seen that striking sight, his mind was haunted by a vague and strange feeling that in nature there were mysterious forms of life beyond the knowledge of man. Fear leads him to feel alienated from what he holds most sacred and changes his behavior. This experience of his boyhood brings upon a poet a profound awareness of the wisdom and spirit of the universe. Nature leads him to these discoveries. In the very first line you will find, Wordsworth says that Mother Nature beckoned him to experience the night. Wordsworth's description of nature is filled with suggestions of peace, of tranquility, or a calm that pervades the landscape. That's very important for this poet. But there are also counter suggestions, the steep and lofty cliffs, the deep seclusion. Nature is working on his imagination. Actually, the nature is working on his imagination. It presses on him and his mind responds, making him evaluate himself, evaluate his guilt. Nature is like a moral guide who chucks our evils, desires. Nature inspires noble thoughts in a person's mind. Now, children, you might have understood the stolen boat here. Now, what I have to give, I have given also figures of speech. Now, for your homework, number one, write down the glossary words from this poem twice. Second, write down the question answers in this poem. And number three, write and explain a reference to context of this poem. Try to take down the explanation notes. Thank you. Thank you very much.